think he was maybe he'll be joining us soon, inshallah. I don't know where he went, but I guess we're gonna wait for Haj Aziz is right here. Assalamu alaikum, Haj.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum, Haj. Bismillah. Yeah,
Sajid bhai, is it turn me off?
Yes, no, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, you're here, brother. Bismillah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان والسماء ورفعها ووزع الميزان ألا تطغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان والأرض ووزعها للأنام فيها فاكهة ونخل ذات الأكمام والحب ذو العصف والريحان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار وخلق الجان من مارج من نار فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان رب المشرقين ورب المغربين فبأي آلاء ربكما
This boy is having some difficulty. This boy, can you hear us? Aziz Bhai.
I think his internet connection is giving problems. So.
Yes. I think he's going to. Let's see if he can reconnect.
Is that from the video of Haji Haider?
Yeah, but I think Aziz Bhai having some difficulty with internet, I think. Should we
proceed for the?
Yeah, I think of maybe we can go ahead and start with Haji Haider.
Yeah.
Inshallah.
Absolutely. Inshallah.
Haj. Are you ready? Bismillah. Brother Aziz is having some internet difficulties there.
He may be reciting and not realizing.
Yes, exactly.
Mashallah. Inshallah, let's start with Haj Haider's presentation. Bismillah, brother.
Bismillah, bismillah. Hang on a second. I need to. How does this work here? Okay, there it is. So, Brother Sajid.
Yes, sir.
So, it's kind of tricky on the. If I'm going to present some slides, I need to hit the present now button, right?
Present now, yeah.
Okay, I'm seeing it. Okay, very good. It's,
it should ask you. Maybe you can select entire screen. That's the easiest option without any trouble.
Right, okay. It's somehow it's a little tricky on this laptop to get the, it's like a sliding thing in the bottom. But inshallah. Okay.
Did you get it?
Yes, but that's for later anyways. I'll do the best I can to approach it smoothly.
Okay.
I haven't completely adjusted, so you have to get used to looking at me. Because I haven't gotten to the point of presenting a slideshow. But bismillah, bismillah, assalamu alaikum, dear brothers and sisters.
Alaikum
assalam.
I thought that inshallah, Friday was not so long ago. And I will continue basically where I left off, present a few more thoughts and reflections on the ayat that I left off with. So this is where we'll start and we'll go for a while. If we fill 30, we fill 30. If we don't, that's fine. Try to say something useful in this time, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Bismillahi wa billahi wa hamdulillahi wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أسلم الله ونعم وكيل ونعم مولى ونعم نصير ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم يا الله بسم الله بسم الله بسم الله I'm going to start with we were last week on 479 and 478, Surah An-Nisa 79 and Surah An-Nisa 78. So I'm going to recite the ayah of Nisa 478, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Aynama takunu yudrikkum mauta walau kuntum fi barujil mashayyada. When tusibhum hasanatun yakulu hadihi min indallah. وَإِن تُصِبْهُمْ سَيِّئَةٌ يَقُولُوا هَذِهِ مِنْ عِنْدِ قُلْ كُلٌّ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ فَمَا لِهَٰؤُلَاءِ قَوْمِ لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا SubhanAllah, this is really, really wonderful ayah here. Let's try to read the English for you. Wherever you are, death will catch up with you, even if you are in high fortresses. If a good thing happens to them, they say, this has come from Allah. But if a bad thing happens to them, they say, this has come from you. Say, everything comes from Allah. What is the matter with these people that they scarcely understand a single word? MashaAllah. Bismillah. So there is, of course, a historical perspective on this ayah, which is related to the groups of people in the city of Medina, Medina Munawwara, that were less than fully committed to the prophetic message. Whether this group is being referred to as of the Jewish tribes, or just what we would now term the Manasseh. It can be somewhat debatable, but it speaks to human nature. It really speaks to human nature. And that's, the Quran is this incredible effulgence. Because this ayah, we could probably spend the next hour just speaking about this ayah. There's so much in it. It's quite an amazing ayah. And what it tells us about ourselves. So we, people, they say that it probably comes after Uhud, where there's been a victory in Badr and a defeat in Uhud. And so people are like, whoa, we thought we were on the winning team and now we've lost. And so they're immediately blaming the Prophet. And everybody wants to be on a winning team. That's just kind of how we are. And faith is sometimes deep and sometimes not so deep. And so the first hadith that I have here to read, we're going to talk about the practicality of faith, comes from our beloved Imam Hussein. The Imam Hussein says, and we've all heard this, this is nothing unusual, we've all heard this before, recited many times, verily, people are slaves of the dunya, and their religion, deen, is superficial, only on their tongues. They are attentive to it as long as their material benefits are provided, but when they are tested, the number of people who are true will dwindle. SubhanAllah. As ayat beautifully illustrates that, the people who wanted to be on the winning team, and when the adversity came, they were like, well, wait a minute, we didn't sign up for this. Just like Imam Hussein is left on the battlefield practically alone. So the ayah is about Karbala. People who say, well, there's Karbala is not mentioned in the Quran. Karbala is mentioned throughout the Quran, if you know how to read it. And am I still with you?
Yes.
Okay. Just checking. I don't want to be speaking and suddenly you're speaking to nobody, not realizing it. It's an interesting medium. So we have that. We have this ayat talking about the sunshine soldiers or the good time friends. That when things get rough, it's like, wait a minute, we didn't sign up for this. It's all on you now. And then there's another aspect of this life. So even if you hide in the high towers, impregnable towers, death is coming for you. Death is coming for you. And that is another aspect of the human condition. We love life. We love life a lot. And this is, as human beings, we can't help ourselves. This is how we were created. Death is a bitter pill. Death is something that no one wants. But there we are. There we are. It's coming. It's decreed. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Bal tu'thiruna hayat ad-dunya wal akhiratu khayrun wa abqa. This is our inclination. There is an interesting factoid about the heartbeat, and that all animals of higher order mammals generally get about the same amount of heartbeats in a lifetime. This is not precise, it's a ballpark figure, but it goes to point out that the mouse, which has a very short life, has a very fast heartbeat, and the elephant, which has a long life, has a very slow heartbeat. And so we see within this that there's a certain of the symmetry in the creational process. But there is one animal that stands out because it cheats and it gets a lot more than it should based on its physiology. And that animal is us. We're very clever. And so we do our best to cheat death in whatever way we can. We got whole healthcare systems built around that. And nonetheless, whether we are in high towers, death is decreed for us. Kulu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. So here we are, sitting at home in our high towers, so to speak. We're all sheltering in place, avoiding the virus, preserving our lives, right? And that's fine. But I wanted to think about that a little bit in terms of the decree of death and the fact that, what is our intention? Should we fear this virus? Am I locked away in my house to avoid dying from this pandemic? And I might say that I want to open this up a little bit, because there's levels here. There's levels of intention. So am I trying to save myself? And so I'm going to lock myself away until this thing goes away? Or am I really thinking about, let's take it up one level. Am I concerned for my family and the fact that I'm a breadwinner for my family? Therefore, I need to survive in order to continue to serve my family. That intention is, you know, a little higher, a little bit more. And it goes further based on your consciousness of the situation. So are we doing it to protect the society? Are we doing it because death is decreed? It's coming. Whether this virus is going to kill me, or I'm going to be hit by a truck tomorrow, or I die in my bed, you know, 30 years from now, very old age. Death is decreed. And so there's a takwini aspect to this. There's a decree. And there's also a tashri'i aspect, and this is what I would recommend we all think about in terms of what our duty is to our society. I had mentioned the greater good in the last talk I gave, and how we're trying to promote the greater good by what we're doing. And that greater good, the health, public health authorities have said we should shelter in place. And then when it's time to stop sheltering in place, there's other things that are coming soon where they're asking us to wear face masks, right? And other types of protection, so that when we do come out of our shelter in place in the next week or so, we won't be just like we were before. And why am I doing this? What is the best intention for me? I want to make this very personal. I want to make this very personal right in front of us. I am doing this, I'm following these orders because I want to save Dr. Karar's life. You don't think of it that way, but that's the reality of the situation with this virus. And not just Dr. Karar, any doctor or healthcare worker in our community. I'm just using him because he's here and very visible at the moment. We have other doctors and nurses and healthcare workers that are connected to us, and then throughout the world. Because it's a known fact that I may get this virus and I may have mild symptoms. But because this virus very much depends on dosage. If you get exposed to a small amount of the virus, you're most likely not going to get terribly ill. But if you're a doctor or a nurse working in a hospital where patients are coming in to you day and night, you are exposed to a lot of this virus. And that's why young, healthy healthcare workers have been dying. Because this virus, they're getting exposed such a high dosage of this virus that their immune systems can't keep up with it. So yes, this is the best intention. The highest intention is not that we're trying to preserve our individual lives or our family's lives. We're trying to preserve the lives of those who serve us. Alhamdulillah, 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 Allah. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. And I apologize for calling out Dr. Farrar in this way, but as I said, he's just the one who's here at the moment. There's many others that we know that are in the healthcare business, and they're all under threat from this condition because they are all there and exposed to it all the time. So I want to think about what this virus is to us. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. This virus is much more than just a disease. This virus is a mirror. If anything, it's a social disease. Because when something like this comes into a community, the true colors of that community come out. As I say, the good, the bad, and the ugly. It shines a light on everything, on all of our social interactions, and of all of the vulnerabilities in that society. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Excuse me while I... I'm going to read a hadith that I read last time. With this in mind about our society. This is from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, there will come a time for my ummah when their rulers will be cruel, their scholars will be greedy and have little piety, their worshippers will be hypocritical, their merchants will commit usury and conceal the defects of their buying and selling, and women will be busy with the ornaments of the world. Hence, at this time, the most vicious of them will dominate over them, and their good doers will invocate, but they will not be answered. Think about the society we're living in now. Think about the massive social inequality that exists. Wealth inequality is one of huge troubling factors in our modern context. Even the wealthy have realized that maybe things have gone too far. Greed rules the day. If one complains about their political leadership, the political leadership is necessarily a reflection of the people on some level or another. And if you're seeing greed and craziness go on, it's a part of our society. And the virus is bringing all this. It's bringing all this to light. There's a good movie. It's probably not suitable for younger people, called The Big Short. If you want to read about or watch, excuse me, there's also a book that the movie was based off of, if you want to read the book, which talks about the collapse in 2008 that we all suffered during, and the amount of incredible greed that was involved with that process. So when I read that hadith about what a cruel place this is, I know we're all getting, most of us at least, we're getting by, right? We're keeping our heads down, we're working our little jobs, trying to keep our family together, but there's bad things happening around us. And when the virus comes, I mean, wow, it really, the craziness comes out. The thing about the virus is you have an unseen enemy. An unseen enemy brings out all kinds of strangeness. And I want to move to a slideshow here. There it goes. So hang on a second. I'm going to present some pictures just to illustrate points and then try to finish up here. This one. Okay. Well, okay, it's not letting me share. So it says to choose what you'd like to share. No.
Can I share again?
That's it? Bismillah. Can people see this picture?
No, Hajj. I don't.
Not yet.
Not yet. Ah, there it is.
Yep. Now we can see it.
Ah. There we go. Thank you. I wanted to present to you by these pictures, tell a, as they say, a picture is worth a thousand words or some such, that the craziness, the virus is making people crazy. So I'm presenting to you American ISIS, or Daesh, if you will. These people are coming out of the woodwork. And like Daesh, they not nice people, not too smart. And they do follow something called Christian identity, many of them, which means they see their Christianity in terms of a nationalistic, ethnic identity. And they are, they're dangerous. And we hopefully we don't hear a whole lot from them, but Allah knows best. We'll see where we are in November. And here's another picture of this is the society. This is, as a society, as healthcare workers, as we're trying to get this virus under control, right? Mm-hmm. And this is what we're up against. Healthcare workers are standing in silent protest. I mean, they are calling to the good. Amr bil ma'ruf wa nahyi an al munkar. As you see again, this is what they're confronting. This is the kind of craziness that's going on in America right now. The virus is making people crazy. And here is the condition of many of our healthcare workers: exhaustion. And it starts in the big cities and it winds out. And that is basically everything I have to Aaron. To illustrate the points. So, as I said, the virus demonstrates to us what kind of society we live in. And I wanted to make that very graphic for everybody. New Zealand, we were living in New Zealand, it's a very different story. If we were living in South Korea, it's a very different story. If we're living in Germany, it's a very different story. So outcomes, where you live and the type of government you have makes a huge difference in the terms of what happens in a pandemic like this. And this brought to mind something else from the Quran, which is, Surah Yusuf. It made me really think again, because we read these stories and they're nice stories and we try to take meanings from them. And Surah Yusuf, he was in the prison and then he was, he interpreted the dreams for the prisoners. And finally, when the king had a dream, Surah Yusuf was brought out of prison. And the king needed his dream interpreted. And Yusuf interpreted that dream. And it was about the seven calves and the seven ears of corn. And it was about the 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine, followed by a year where everything got better again. And Yusuf then was given charge of preparing for these 7 years of famine. And now I look at that and I say, wow, that's amazing. Because that takes good government. A wise government plans, prepares for these types of disasters. A wise government isn't just living life on a limb. So you realize actually, this is not a guarantee that you have a wise government that knows what to do when the crisis comes. Surah Yusuf demonstrates to us that this is actually quite a special quality. And the fact that the people united behind him and followed him and his wisdom is huge. So that is basically, I'd like to bring up one further point. We have a little bit of time left here. And that, it occurred to me as we watched this virus progress? And it's really, I mean, it's really shocking, actually, if you consider where we were 2 months ago, or 3 months ago, even, when people had barely heard of this thing, how rapidly things have become the way they are. And it occurred to me that human beings are not very good at wrapping their heads around exponential growth. And we don't really comprehend exponential growth very well. So exponential growth can really take you by surprise. It is something that, it's a little thing, and you can ignore it, and you can say it'll go away, and then it's a little bigger, and it's still, and so, and suddenly, boom, boom, suddenly it's like, wow. Suddenly you're in crisis. And this is one of those things which, obviously, even myself, I really could hardly believe what happened when it happened. To watch whole cities being inundated by this thing when just a week before it seemed like everything was basically okay. So I went to the Quran and I pulled a verse because the Quran does speak about exponential growth. And this ends this talk on a very positive note, because the Quran's point in exponential growth, I believe it's Surah 6, 160. It says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, man ja'a bil hasanati falahu ashru amthaliha, wa man ja'a bil sayyati fala tajza illa mithlaha wa hum la yuzlamun. The person who does a good action, a hasana, it will be rewarded 10 times. And the person who does the sayyat, who does the evil, he will just get one. So here is an example of exponential growth and the mercy of Allah. It's going in the direction of mercy. The exponential growth in your actions and doing hasana now, and helping other people and doing things that help yourself and the community. This is worth 10 times. This is the exponential growth that defeats the virus. And then there's another ayah that takes it even further. I think this is Surah Al-Baqarah 2261. And I'm just gonna read the English here, where it says, the parable of those who spend their wealth in the way of Allah, if you're doing this hasana with the proper intention, is that of a grain which grows 7 ears, and every ear is 100 grains. Allah enhances several fold whomever he wishes, and Allah is bounteous and all knowing. So when we're talking about exponential growth, look at this, subhanAllah. It's more than 10 times over. It's ghayru mamnoon. So we have this as good news from Allah, as we sit in place and we follow our public health authorities and we try to preserve the people we love and know and are serving our communities as best we can, that mercy goes in one direction and the mercy outweighs the wrath. And we have that as a message of hope in the Quran. Inshallah, I hope I've been able to say a few useful things. I'm sorry for the technical difficulties. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. May Allah give us all patience.
Ameen.
And may Allah give us all strength. Ameen. With the patience with the decree and strength to endure the decree. And may Allah give us, may Allah open our hearts, and may Allah bring us all together again soon, in a better condition, and may Allah preserve the health and well-being and the livelihoods of all of us in this community and beyond, because we are all one human family. We are either brothers in faith, brothers and sisters in faith, or we are brothers and sisters in humanity. And this is what the imams and our anbiya affirm, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam, Hajj. Asante. Alhamdulillah, beautiful presentation and beautiful words for the hope. I loved it the way you ended it, Hajj. The hope, the tawakkal of Allah is the period for everything, exclamation for every ending. It'd be the disasters from the previous qawms that Allah has talked about, and the wrath of the prophets in the past who has given to the people, and what we are seeing is a little minute part of that we are going through. But the hope is what keeps up, and that's the beautiful thing that Allah has given us. He's in His impound mercy, inshallah. We'll have the dua, inshallah, Haji.
Yeah, Haji Karar, can you offer Surah Al-Fatiha? My cousin died today in Najaf.
May Allah give him maghfirah.
May Allah bless all of
him. Bless him and may give him maghfirah and highest place, inshallah, and protect him and his family. Let's do the Surah Fatiha for him.
عظم الله أجركم حج منذر عظم الله أجركم.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you for the fatah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma zayyinni fihi.